tiny. Normally I look big beside anyone. That's good. Okay. Hi YouTube, I'm here with Legend. Today you're lucky, I'm going to interview the first ever foreign, first ever Irish Yokozuna, Aki Bono. You are Irish, right? Chad Rowan, Irish name. So, you're famous, of course, for sumo, not only sumo, but also wrestling, and you've had a long and successful career in Japan, but I wanted to start a little bit with the sumo. So recently you seem like you're getting back into it a little bit, or involved with things, so...
Well, right now the reason why it looks that way is because now the oyakatas and the people who are moving up in the ranks, in the oyakata ranks, they're all around the same time I was in sumo. So I was actually like the big one right now is Takano Hana Oyakata. He was my rival from day one when I stepped foot into the sumo association. So because of that rivalry, now we have a friendship, and I tell them anytime, even if I left the sumo association, I am still able to do what I do today because of sumo. So if they ever need anything from me, don't hesitate to ask, and I'll be there.
Are you still involved as a coach and as a
manager? I try and help and coach at Azumazeki, but like you know that it's a total different generation right now, so it's a little hard for me to coach the way we were brought up in sumo. And
you mean it's a lot softer than it was, or
it's not? I wouldn't say softer, but I would say it's different. I wouldn't say softer. One of the problems I run into is when I go and watch Keiko. It's basically based around calisthenics, not actually wrestling sumo. You know, these guys can do beautiful skull. They can raise their legs high, their body all flexible. But if they don't know how to wrestle, it doesn't mean anything.
So what you're saying, in your day, a bigger percentage of keiko would have been
based around keiko, yes.
Yeah, that's kind of interesting, because I went out to Tamanoyabe the other day, and after they finished keiko, they went out of their ring and came back wearing shorts and spent an hour doing like kettlebell swings and, you know, handstand.
Yes, it's a total different thing. Yeah. When we were growing up in sumo, my oyakata, you know, he was the first Hawaiian wrestler to come in the 60s. He used to yell at us, if you guys get enough energy to lift weights after practice, you're not practicing hard enough.
That's good. I like that. See, actually, you met Takano Hana recently. You were in Jimgyo, right?
Yes.
So like the first time in 12 years you were standing on the dojo together. Yeah. What was that about? It was just you were visiting?
Or? I actually got the promoter who did that Jimgyo. He actually does promotions for pro wrestling. So as a surprise, he asked me if I could come, because Takano Hana Oyakata made Jimgyo Bucho.
Right.
So as a surprise, he asked me if I could come, and I told him, yeah, if you need me, just let me know.
Yeah, I mean, he's lost so much weight since he's retired, right? It's a strange thing, the two of you. You didn't look like rivals at all, you know, former rivals. But you had an interesting discussion on Facebook the other day with one of the American sumo guys. You were talking about a pro sumo league. And like doing it more like a wrestling style with, you know, flashy lights and entrances and stuff like that. And you said that you'd be kind of interested in getting involved with that or set up. So,
you know, that's always in the back of my mind. The reason why I still do professional wrestling and stuff is so I can actually stay in the media. And my dream is to actually start something where I can have like a minor league of Japanese sumo.
Okay.
Where you can actually get foreign wrestlers from that league. The same way they do like with the Daigakusei here in Japan. Right.
So the university system now is working like a feeder system, or like the amateur system. But you're not talking about an amateur thing like they have now, right? You're talking about an actual pro league.
An actual pro.
Are you talking about something like they had in Madison Square Garden? I don't know if you saw that like 10 years ago. They had a big thing there.
And yes, but my fear about those things is people with money who do not know too much about sumo.
Mm.
That's the one thing I'm afraid of. If somebody like Donald Trump comes out and just throws cash and says, make me a sumo gi. You know, they'll get all kind of, they'll make it silly. That's the thing I'm afraid of.
But you wouldn't want, like, you know, top mage and
To me, I feel what I want to try and do is, as a spectator sport, the Japanese Sumo Association is here for a reason to carry on those traditions of the mage, why they throw salt, why they do foot stomping. What I want to do is, I want to make it more a spectator-friendly sport. You know, you could do little stuff like, maybe you have a 16-man tournament for the championship. The first rounds, maybe you do two out of three. Because, you know, once somebody touch it, they jump on the side, it ends so fast. Most of the crowd doesn't know, and they have no replays when you're in the arena right now in a professional sumo association.
Right.
So, you know, you make it two out of three, so then you make the finals, maybe three out of five.
That's interesting. That's completely different than the whole thing.
I think you make it, if you try doing something like that, it'll be more of a spectator sport worldwide.
Okay. I mean, obviously I've been involved with the amateur sumo side for a decade or more, and there's a lot of athletes who would do that, but I mean, the biggest problem amateur sumo has is lack of funds and lack of funding. You know, people have to pay to travel around the world, and there's a lot of fighting and political infighting in it, but I think if there was a proper setup and a proper league, it would be definitely something. Oh, yes. There are people. There are enough people definitely to do it. But
I know that. Yeah. I know that. And that's why right now I'm just trying to get people who would support the idea. And because myself, I cannot do it myself. I eventually seen this league as, like you said, a feeder system. The person who wins this year's championship, they can take maybe from 1, 2, 3, 4. And then that would make the, to me, I feel it would make the sumo association look a whole lot better instead of you only can have so many foreigners in one stable.
But you don't think there'd be a lot of resistance to that idea in the Kyokai?
Not itself? If Takanohana becomes.
Yeah, but he kind of got shoved out.
Yeah, but he's still young. So he still has a chance.
Yeah, you think he'll come back? Yeah. He has a lot of, when he first became a Noyakata, he was talking about getting rid of the Heia system completely. And, myself, over the last couple of years, as I've seen like what goes on in Heias, and you know, it worked a long time ago, but I think it's harder and harder to get recruits and ask them to come into that kind of feudal society.
Well, you know, to me, I feel the reason why is because they let anybody open their own Heia.
Okay.
So if you change, maybe not get rid of the whole Heia situation, but maybe only Yokozunas and Ozekis can become.
Okay.
And then that forces everybody to stay at that stable, not go out and break out and one Oyakata and one Desi, and that'll make a Heia.
But then you mean reduce the number of Heia completely?
Yeah. You know, like how it used to be way back in the old days. You had one Oyakata, then you had all the Heia Tsuki Oyakata. You had that 100 wrestlers in one stable.
Yeah, I haven't even a third of that now in the biggest one. It's different. You did in WrestleMania, you did that kind of thing against Big Show, right? But that's nothing like that, right? That was just a completely different thing, right? So on the pro side, in your career, you did a lot of things. I mean, you went to Austria, I think you went to London and Paris as well, right? And Canada.
Yes.
And, of course, you did the Olympic opening ceremony. So outside of the ring, what was the biggest highlight of your sumo career, would you say?
I mean, I had a great career. I was here when the economy in Japan was booming. I was sumo is very popular right now, but it was a different type of popularity back in that day.
Right.
I mean, it was like when we went overseas, we was traveling in place of the emperor.
Right.
And there's a lot different than it is today. I had a lot besides having my kids and getting married, I don't know what else. I had too many to do.
So, I mean, in those days, there were a lot of Hawaiians, obviously, in Samoa. In each stable, you had, you know, so your brother was in there for a while and different things. And now, obviously, they've introduced the rules where they only allow one foreigner. Do you think that rule should be got rid of and go back to the days where it was just opened up? And
I feel whoever wants to come in and learn seriously should be open to anybody.
Do you think the popularity back then was part of the reason was because it was open to anyone, like it was truly the best of the best? You feel it's a little bit limited now because maybe there are a lot of people who want to get in, or potential great rikishi who can't because it's closed to them?
You know, that could be a good point. I never did think of it that way. But having those roadblocks, you don't know who is filtering through just because there's not enough space.
Well, I mean, yeah, because I get contacted by guys all the time. You know, I helped Austin Arashi join and, you know, a few other guys and stuff. But there's been a lot of guys who've contacted me who didn't get in. Just recently, I had a guy who's a young guy. You know, you never know how someone will do, but I think he had potential, you know, and just couldn't find a place for him. There was only one possible heir, but they had just taken somebody else. So, you know, I think he could have been Makuuchi in the future at least. So, you know, there is a little bit of me that thinks that the competition is kind of diluted, that they've, you know, stopped letting everybody in. But, you know, your post sumo life now has actually been longer than your sumo life in Japan. So, of course, when you came with sumo, you know, it was difficult. And, you know, you in the book Gaijin Yokozuna that was written maybe 10 years ago, you know, it was detailed, a lot of that stuff. But one of the things about sumo, it was very structured. So you went in and everything was decided for you. So the difficulty was of a different kind. But after sumo, was it more difficult in a way because you were suddenly on your own and you were young? I mean, you're retired, but you were still really young. You were like, you know, most people are still just at the start of their working life. But then you had to go and make another life and another career. Was that more difficult in the sense?
Well, I actually, some of the problems that they're having with sumo right now is what I was trying to tell them at the time that I was at Oyakata.
For example?
For example, putting roadblocks on the foreigners.
Okay.
Like you said, diluting the competition. Mm. At that time, sumo was still popular, so there was just in that frame of mind, we don't have to do that. We don't have to do this. We just sit here and we sell tickets, and then eventually it all went downhill, and then they started changing some stuff.
How much did that play into your decision to actually leave sumo? Was that part of it, or was it just
yes,
you?
Yes, it was part of it. Yeah. There was a lot that I wanted to become a oyakata. Mm. It's a lot of responsibility. Mm. I've seen a lot of young kids come in, the oyakata go to the house, and we're going to make your kid build him up, maybe one day he become Yokozuna, who knows? Yeah. Then once the kid get hurt, they just push him on the side. I've seen a lot of those in my career, I've seen a lot of that, and I didn't want to be like that. Yeah. I felt the responsibility of raising my own children, and I didn't know if I had what it took to take somebody else's, the responsibility of taking somebody else's child and promising that I'll send him back a man. Mm. It was all little things like that. The biggest thing that made me leave was I actually asked if there was a chance of me become Bijicho.
Really?
Yeah.
And you were told no. Yeah.
So I told him there's no future for me in the Sumo Association. So I decided to.
So you had the ambition to not only be the first foreigner to make Yokozuna, but the first foreigner to be head of the Sumo Association.
Well, if you go through the ranks and you go, even if it was just for a year, or even just for one tournament.
Yeah, I can understand that. I have the ambition to be the first on the Yokozuna Deliberation Council. That's what I want to do. Actually, your kohai from Hawaii, Sashimaru, I've been to his stable quite a bit, and in that respect, what you were just talking about, as like a substitute parent, he's incredible. I mean, he's out there, he goes out and he recruits, he's building the stable every day, he's in there early and he's giving advice, and, you know, he has, of course, some guys that probably don't have the greatest future ahead of them, you know, some that have like some physical difficulties, but he's mentoring them, he gets in the ring, so, yeah, it's good to see that there are some places like that, you know. I mean, but it is, I talked to him about that, and he's like, you got to put in the hours, you got to put in the work, you got to be there every day in Keiko, you got to be going out and doing people, so you can't rely on other people to do it for you. If you're an oyakata, you got to do it yourself, so, yeah, it is a big responsibility. Do you feel any regret about leaving? No? No. You're happy the way everything went in the end. Okay. So you just held your first event under your own promotion, Odo.
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about that, how that came about?
To me, because I came from a sumo background, I think I felt the same way you look at the sumo wrestlers now. So it's the same thing that, to me, I feel is happening in pro wrestling. They're so worried about, most of the wrestlers are so worried about how they look. Like if they have six packs or if their hair is all slicked back. But they don't just go out there and wrestle for the pure enjoyment of wrestling. Or going out there doing sumo for pure enjoyment of sumo. So I figured I paid my dues. I've been in the pro wrestling league now for, this is my 11th year. So I figured it was what I couldn't do in sumo, maybe I could do here in pro wrestling. So I decided to open my, it would be the same as opening a stable.
Okay.
So eventually I plan on taking in younger wrestlers. And
so you're really hoping to grow this promotion and turn it into like a big thing. Do you have a lot of people in it right now?
Right now, for my first match that I had, Odo actually came from Mr. Baba, Giant Baba. I got the blessings from his wife to actually use the name and try and make pro wrestling back to how it was when he was wrestling, just for the pure love of the sport or the pure love of wrestling. And right now, the two guys from Odo is myself and another from Hawaii, Taiyo Kia.
Okay.
He was actually one of Baba-san's last trainees, last deshis. So right now, me and him are like the two top in Odo, and hopefully.
So what makes Odo different from the other promotions? How do you try and get back to that old style?
It's the way you just run things, like the way you run the whole promotion. Not everything is about money. It's just little things like that. Like Sashimaru Oyakata said, you gotta put in the time, you gotta be there every day. I'll be 47 this year and I still go to the gym every morning. After the gym, I go to the office, I see what needs to be done.
So about that point, I mean, 47, I'm 42. I was doing amateur sumo for a while and like even I had to give it up, but 47, it's not easy to keep going and keep training, you know. I mean, the recovery time gets longer and, you know, it hurts more and more. So, I mean, how long more do you think you can keep going? Like,
I think as an active, really in the middle, in the mix, I think, until I'm 50.
50?
Yeah.
Okay, so 3 more years. Yeah. Okay. And after that, then you just move into the promotion side of it completely?
Well, hopefully.
Oh, okay. Okay. So, excuse me, a few years ago when I was writing an article for the 10th anniversary of September 11th attacks, I contacted you and I was asking about your memories of that time, but actually you had a very interesting story about your Danpatsushiki and I was involved.
Yeah.
So can you tell us
my Intai Sumo, my retirement sumo was after the September Basho. So at that time, because of being the first American Yokozuna. I had a lot of, actually all the bases. I sold out the top floor of the arena of Ryogoku to all the military bases.
Right.
So they were all gung-ho to come and watch, and not a lot of them want to watch sumo, but they don't know how to get in and stuff like that. So they were very excited to come, and then 9/11 happened. At that time, we had on the tickets that it's non-refundable, but you know, you don't expect stuff like that to happen. So I actually got back about 5,000 tickets. They gave back like 1 week before the dump was here.
So you actually refunded everything to them? But then were you able to get rid of those tickets again?
I just gave them out to anybody who wanted to come.
Really? That's the one point I didn't ask you about that. So you got 5,000 people's payment less than you would have expected. Wow.
See, but it's not all about the money.
Right. Right. Yeah, I suppose. Well, I mean, when something like that happens anyway, you can't be thinking about money, right? So, of course, like you said, you're involved in the wrestling and everything, and you're still sometimes involved in the sumo. But just there at New Year's, you came back to K1. Well, not K1, sorry, it was Ryzen. But that was almost 10 years since you'd fought in mixed martial arts.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you know, everyone pretty much knows that Ryzen, the X-Pride, people were throwing money around. Like, you know, if the rumors are true, I would have gotten in the ring and fought anyone for that money. But is that, apart from being like, you know, if being offered silly money or stuff like that, do you still have an itch to do that? Or is the whole mixed martial arts thing, is that satisfied? Or do you?
It is satisfied. The only reason why I got back in the ring was because it was Bob Sapp.
Oh, just because it was Bob Sapp? Really?
When they came and see me, I told him, if it's not Bob Sapp, I ain't fighting. I ain't getting in the ring.
Really? Why did you want to fight Bob Sapp?
Because that was the first guy I fought, and I lost the way I lost. You know, for the Japanese people, that was, I guess, a shock. To the Japanese people, the older generation,
to see you lose to Bob Sapp
the way I lost.
Okay,
because you know at that time the Japanese people sumo was number one.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you know Bob personally outside the thing?
I know. We talk, but it's not like me and him went out to go dinner and stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah, and then like unfortunately you got cut in the head and. Actually, you ended up going to the hospital, I think, with that, right?
Until I punched Street.
You don't want a third shot of him, no? Maybe another 10 years?
Nah. Yeah, maybe we can do wheelchair.
Yeah, Bob Sapp, you know, I'm a Bears fan. You know, he was drafted by the Bears, so it's really strange for me to see somebody like former Yokozuna fighting a Bears draft choice. You know, it's like some surreal thing. But, yeah, yourself. Henry Miller, Sentoru, Baruto recently, Waka Kirin, and a few others have actually gotten into the mixed martial arts rings or K1 rings and stuff like that. But for me, sumo is not, it doesn't really lend itself to that sport because the whole thing about conditioning and the way to fight. I mean, you know, you train 5 or 6 hours in Keiko, Rikishi have stamina, but it's a different kind of stamina, right?
Yeah.
Stop, start. So, it's kind of surprising to see so many ex-rikishi try a sport that.
Well, like you said, we retire. When we retire still young.
Right.
Most of us retire because of injuries. Maybe 99% of us retire because of injuries. But because sumo is an all-year-round sport, there's no time for you to heal your injuries unless you take, if you kyujo.
Right.
But if you're not the Yokozuna, you kyujo, that means you drop down. You drop in ranks. So, like, these guys, they get so beat up so bad. Then they realize that they sit out for maybe 6 months. And one morning you get up, oh, I can move now. And then you start. See, a lot, like I said, a lot of us retired because of injury. We didn't retire because we lost the itch to fight or compete. Then when your body starts moving, then that itch starts coming back.
Do you think that we should reintroduce the kosho system where they let people hold their rank for a while?
Yeah, if it's really something real. Like, look at Santorio.
Right.
His knees. He barely can. He get like, well, he's, at that time, he was walking around on like 70-year-old knees. Konishiki-san the same way. Mm. And people say, oh, because he was big. It's not because he was big. It was because all that pounding. Mm.
I mean, that's, you know, you pay a price with your body. Oh, yeah, you do. You know? I mean, everyone I've seen who's done it has, even, it's a different thing, but even I was an amateur. I broke this arm top to bottom, split into three sections. Like, I'd never broken a bone in my life before I did sumo. So it's really hard to explain to people just how violent it is, you know? They've never done it.
And they're watching sumo with rules now.
Yeah.
Because back in the old days, they wrestled until they break it.
Right. And shovel across the back of the head or something like that. Do you get the same buzz from the wrestling as you did from the sumo?
Yes, the competing aspect of the competing side of it. It's the same thing that people did. It's just like you, like you just said, you're 47 years old and you still get, it's just like me getting up if I was in, still in sumo, getting up early in the morning, send the kids off to school, go to the gym, work out, get my keiko in, and then I come home, I like, now I had to go run, do something before this, but I have lunch, have my chanko, and then I do my work.
So you've kind of kept the same lifestyle.
My lifestyle is,
not that changed, right? No, that's interesting. You know, we talked a little bit about how they've diluted the competition by not allowing foreigners in. But, you know, there's only been one Japanese Yusha winner in the last 10 years, after a 10-year gap, right? Even with that diluted competition. And, you know, if you think back to when you became Yokozuna, I mean, those people having heart attacks, you know, there was an idea that a foreigner couldn't physically or psychologically even be a Yokozuna, you know? And just even winning an occasional Yusha, you just bring out all the worst side of, like, you know, the nationalists and everything. But, you know, now it's, the idea of a Japanese winning a Yusha is almost laughable. But what's happened? Is it just the dominance of the Mongolians, or is there something that it's gotten lost in Japanese sumo, or how do you think
it's not only in the Japanese sumo, it's in the Japanese culture, period.
Really?
I feel it's in the Japanese culture, period.
What is that change?
I'm not trying to sound racist or anything, but I think they become too Americanized.
Too Americanized? Too individualistic, you mean?
Or? It's not like when you go out into the countryside and you see kids carrying bales of rice like back in our day, where one family would have 4 or 5 kids, not enough money to feed all of them, so you send one to sumo. It's one, maybe one or two kids now. They're so, how do you explain it?
You mean the life is softer, or?
I feel, yes.
Just growing up,
it's
the hardship.
Easy. Yeah, it's easier.
So that's, I mean, Mongolia, obviously, it's not as developed as Japan, so they're growing up is a lot harder.
Well, I went, I was lucky enough for when Asa Shoryu was still wrestling, he took me to, right when I retired.
Oh, yeah, you went to Mongolia together, right?
And I was still surprised to see kids chasing horses and barefooted. And I looked at them and I told Asa Shoryu, that's where the Mongolians beat everybody. You don't see that anymore.
And of course they have the, you know, I mean, you understand this too. If you go to another country, you can't go home if you don't succeed. Like, there's the shame element, the shame, right? Yeah. To go back without succeeding is just, you know, you might as well not go home, you know, so. But, do you see that changing? Do you see that the Japanese coming back to prominence? Or once like Hakuho is retired, or is it just going to be generation after generation? Because the actual number of foreigners is much lower, but they're all just concentrated at the top of the band scale. Right? So.
Not in the near future.
Not in the near future, no.
Because look, you got a whole new generation of Mongolians right now knocking on the door at Ozeki and at Sekiwake and coming up. And
right. This is going to continue for a while. How about Hawaiians? Would you like to see Hawaiians come back into it?
Yes, it was. I feel it's part of the problem is because we left the Sumo Association, myself, Konishiki-san.
But do you think life for young Hawaiians now is same as for Japanese. It's easier than it was for you guys. So it's they don't have the toughness.
No, not in Hawaii.
No.
Not in Hawaii. If you go where we come from.
Right.
No. Yeah. You still have kids running around the park barefooted, running in the sand. You know, that's actually all training when you're growing up.
Right.
You know, like the Yokozunas before in Japan, they all came from the north.
Right.
That's because they had to walk to school in the snow, not somebody drive you to school.
Well, where you came from was like paradise on earth. When I was growing up as a kid in Ireland, I used to watch Magnum P.I. And it was set out there in Waimanalo Beach, you know?
Yeah, but we don't live where Magnum live. Like, my kids know this. I mean, they even haven't seen a food stamp.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not a bad thing in a way, but, you know. Yeah, I suppose.
Have you ever seen a food stamp? What's a food stamp?
Food stamp, yeah.
Yeah, wow. we got that kind of, not book smart training, but street smart.
Mm.
Like how you take $3 of food stamp and turn it into cash.
It sounds like, you know, when I talk as well a little bit like this kind of stuff recently, it makes me feel like I'm my grandfather talking to me when I was there. Because the generation gap is so big nowadays.
Yeah, that's the same thing I tell a lot of people too, is when we was coming up in Sumer, Takamiyama-san used to tell us, you guys get everything easy. And I thought I was breaking my butt.
Yeah.
So I used to think to myself, how hard was sumo before?
Yeah, I suppose things get easier. Or maybe just we get older and we think it was harder. Yeah. You know, I don't know. But so what, outside of the wrestling, outside of sumo, what other projects are you involved in now? Or like, is there anything that you want to be involved in the future?
No, but I keep my eye on that. Eventually starting my professional sumo association.
That's a big thing for you, right? You're really interested in that. How about the acting, though? You have bits in commercials and movies and stuff.
That's all just like bonus.
Yeah.
Bonus. It's not something I would actually try and go after.
You don't get the same enjoyment for something like that? No, really?
Not like how I did. I don't know if you've seen my Facebook post from yesterday when I went up to...
Niigata.
Yamakoshi.
Okay. What was that? That was a charity event or something? You were like doing sumo with kids?
Actually, what it was that town is specialized in raising koi. Carp fish. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What we did was I'm the fukuriji, like the for a charity in Chiba.
Okay.
And this guy who does the Chiba charity stuff.
Sure.
I knew him from when I was a shindeshi in sumo.
Okay.
And we do a lot of events, but it was mostly in Chiba. Sure. So what he did was he actually built like a little farm. There's ponies.
Okay.
The chickens, stuff like that. So the handicapped, we bring the handicapped children and stuff over. Once a year, we have like a grand opening matsuri. So what he did was he dug a pond to get raised koi.
Okay.
And that's where we went to go get the koi. So he was going back and forth for how many years getting the koi.
Mm.
And he said, one day I'll bring akebono. So we planned, and then this time I was able to go when he was going. So actually, we went there to go just to go get the fish.
Mm.
But when they found out we was coming, the thing turned into a hole.
Mm. I don't know if that's a Hawaiian trait, like that thing about helping people, but like before we start filming this, I was thanking you. You've always, whenever I've called you up and asked you for quotes, or, you know, the time of the earthquake, you gave me a lot of stuff to auction off to raise funds for Tohoku, and like Konishiki's going up there every year and constantly doing his Santa stuff. And is it just something you guys are raised with, or is it just something based in the Hawaiian culture, like that need to help people? Or is it just because you grew up, like you said, without a lot of stuff, so you feel like you have to give back to people? Or?
Well, it's a lot of things. Those things are included. But for me, the biggest reason is I would hope that if something was able to happen in Hawaii and we this far away, that people would step up who can step up. And that's the biggest, you know, part of being the responsibility of being who we are in Japan. Mm. That's part of the responsibility. Mm.
Do you still feel, even though you retired now, 15 years, more than 15 years, do you still feel that Yokozuna responsibility that never goes, or?
Yes, I do. And, you know, people still call me Yokozuna, but it's not like I'm forcing them. Mm. If you live your life the right way, that name will always be there.
But I mean, obviously you have a lot more freedom now in your life. You don't have to follow the rules of the Sumo Association.
I mean, I don't follow. If I was following the rules of the Sumo Association, I wouldn't have tattoos.
Right. Was it a big relief to be able to, you know, I see like you, Henry as well, like, you know, a lot of guys, Nishiki's got bright red or yellow hair or whatever, like that, because you're in such a restricted environment for so long, is it a reaction to that? That once you're free, you're like, I'll do all the stuff I could have done.
Maybe
once.
the first 2-3 years.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you think they should loosen it up a little bit, the sumo world, like that? Or is the, you know, is it too restrictive in a way?
Well, I feel it's loosened a lot since we were. Mm. I mean, when I was in sumo, I had to, even if I just wanted to go home, I had to let them know when I was leaving, when I was coming back. Now they just go. Come back whenever. I feel it's changed a lot from when we were wrestling. Mm.
You know, arguably you're probably the most successful foreign person ever to come to Japan.
Nah.
Well, I mean, what you did in becoming a Yokozuna, that was something that many, many people just couldn't even imagine a foreigner doing. Lots of people have had success in different areas, but you didn't just break a barrier. You broke into a place that people felt was only something Japanese people could understand or do. But, you know, there's a lot of people come to Japan doing different things and kind of thinking of coming and living here. So what is the thing that helps you succeed in Japan? Like, what advice would you give to people who are thinking of coming? Because it's such a different culture. I mean, you're someone who has succeeded at the highest level here. So if somebody was thinking of coming to Japan, what would you tell them that they need to change in their thinking, or what would they need to do to be successful here?
For me, myself personally, I would say the first thing is get rid of that Japanese and that, because I it's hard for me to explain, but I know this is Japan, but you need to get rid of that because it's
the idea of it being Japan being different.
Get rid of that idea. Mm. If you act human, like how they say, do unto others as you want done. If you do that, it should be easy to succeed.
So you think that's exaggerated a lot, that whole thing about Japan being different and hard to adapt to? That's not really.
Well, like, because I come from Hawaii, we have the way I was brought up was closer to a Japanese style than it was the American style.
Okay.
So it was easy for me. When I first came to sumo, when I first got asked, and then I was making my passport and my visa. Mm. I used to get told every day from the old Japanese folks in Hawaii, Sumo is hard, you're going to the state where they're going to beat you up, do this and do that. And then I finally came, I smirked, I said, living with my mom was harder than
tough upbringing. But your sumo stable was tough, Jesse was notoriously harder on you than on everyone else, right?
Hey, if he wasn't, I probably wouldn't have been. Well, you know, it's 50-50. I honestly believe if it wasn't his stable, I wouldn't have. I maybe would have made Yokozuna, but not as fast as I did. Maybe not in the style that I did.
Because he was so hard on you.
Because he was hard on me.
So, you know, recently, I don't know if you follow American sports much these days, but Kobe Bryant retired. So when you see someone like that retiring, does it bring back, you know, someone who's at like the top level, does it bring back a lot of memories of your
own retirement? Well, you see, like, you know, stuff like that. It's like not too many presidents and prime ministers retire, and they say that it's like the changing of the guards, the guards. Mm-hmm. But in sports, a lot of people, like when Michael Jordan retired, it's the next generation team, you know, of the guards. So I was just happy that I was be able to, like myself, Takanohana, Musashimaru, when we when we retired, it was like the next generation.
How do you think you'd do against those guys, or how do you think they would have done in your era?
You know, a lot of people ask me that, about that a lot.
Konishiki said Hakoho wouldn't have met Sekiwake when he was active.
See, you know, I would like to say the same thing. I said I would say they probably be Maegashira
Yeah.
But you never know, and that's the interesting thing about sumo. And it was the same way when we came up, Chiyono Fujisan.
Right.
Hokutomi-san, they was all on their way out. So even if Takanohana beat him at 17, 18, whatever he was, could he have handled Chiyono Fujisan when he was 21 or 22?
Right.
And it was the same way with his dad. His dad lost to the young Chiyono Fujisan and ended up...
You never got a chance to fight against the Mongolians, right? Against Asashiro. Well, obviously, Asashiro, no, but Hakuho or any of those guys, right? So... I mean, is there a desire to see how you would have done, or no? Nah, it's like different generations.
Different generations.
You don't care. Yeah. So, what would have been, let's say, your most memorable bout in your history? Which one sticks with you the most when you think back on your career?
The first time I ever wrestled Takanohana.
Back when you were in Maizuno?
Jonokuchi.
That's a famous one, right? Where you showed him at the ring, right? But, that's still the most memorable one to you. Why is that?
You know, at that time there was the rock stars of the sumo association, and they just joined. You know, they would be on the front page almost every day of the newspaper. I remember when that was my third match in Jonokuchi. We both 2-0, and I remember that one like it was yesterday. I got up, I did my keiko, I went Aiza's oyakata. Told him, Basho itikimasu. He turned around and he told me, oh, just don't get hurt. Like, oh, you cannot beat him anyway, so just don't get hurt. So I, when he told me that, the switch went on. I went to the Basho. I thought to myself, these two guys, their uncle and their father, ex-Yokozuna and retired Ozeki. My dad is a taxi driver, so what? I went out there, I did what I was taught to do. I came back to the Stakubia, took off my maoshi. In fact, I don't even think I took off my maoshi. I just put my yukata over, wrapped my obi. I wanted to be the one personally from my mouth that told him I won. Got back to the stable as fast as I could. Went to Aizaz him. He was standing by the front door. He told me, oh, congratulations, you cut off my cut in it.
That's, you know, I heard almost the same story from Osir Arashi when he had Endo joined sumo, you know. He came in the golden boy of amateur sumo, and like, you know, his oyakata, he said, and the stable guy said to him, look, don't worry, you can't beat him, just don't get hurt. And it's like exactly the same thing that you said. Once he heard that, he was like, we'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see. And he was exactly the same. He said, yeah, just come back. So, yeah, that kind of thing. Somebody says that to you, definitely.
Yeah.
That's motivating. So what's in the immediate future? We'll say over the next few months or so, what have you got planned for Odo or for some other things?
I have my next Odo is in May, May 15th. We're doing a charity match down in Yamaguchi.
Okay.
August, we're doing another event in August 4th in Hirosaki, and the proceeds from this will all go to helping out the earthquake victims and stuff like that. Other than that, it's just take it day by day.
I mean, you just seem every day is filled with stuff. Do you ever just relax and do nothing, or I mean, are you just on the go constantly?
Basically, just on the go constantly.
Is that, do you enjoy that? Is that the life you like, being busy all the time? Or
I try to schedule all my stuff during the weekdays because my kids are in school. And then weekends, we have family time. So.
Okay. I'm glad I didn't disturb you during the weekend.
Nah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Very, very interesting.